All right. Thanks, Francois. And thanks to the organizers for inviting me and for putting together such a great conference on the power of these animal models. I think it's been truly impressive and educational. What I'd like to talk to you about is our biopsy techniques, and I think the importance of looking at the tissues has been gone over over and over again from the first talk by Jeff Lifson through Jonah's talk and Tom and Philip's recent presentation, Claire. So I won't belabor that point, but sampling tissues is incredibly important. As we've talked about, N of 4 studies are probably not the way to go. So we do typically want to be able to prepare to sample large sample sizes and do those frequently. So we need a high throughput. We want a low complication rate, and I'm not talking about what Cindy was talking about, losing animals. What I'm talking about here is actually a very low complication rate, needing antibiotics or needing some anti-inflammatory. So we don't even use those in the vast majority of our animals. We want a high success rate. We don't want missing data points. We want the ability to sample multiple time points frequently. We heard about some of the latency reversal work, so obviously, and the vaccine work, broadly neutralizing antibodies. There's a opportunity to sample sort of pre and post challenge, pre and post these different interventions at the time of right before we take ART, do a ART release, things like that. So we want to be able to do that frequently. We want to be able to combine procedures to get a broad look across the different sites, the mucosal sites, the lymphoid sites, BAL, CSF, whatnot. We want low impact to the animals. As I mentioned, you know, we don't want, you know, systemic inflammation. We don't want microbial transportation, things that could impact our disease outcomes. And so the techniques I'll be talking about meet these criteria. You know, preferably we'd like to use consistent analgesics and anesthetics so that we get we don't have those confounding variables. For our models, we use sustained release buprenorphine as our workhorse analgesic, so we're nice and consistent. Combine that with some local anesthesia in some of these biopsies for a nice consistent low immunological impact analgesia. Anesthetic-wise, we're using ketamine-dexmedetomidine combination. It's a great combination. The dexmedetomidine is reversible, so we can get animals down quickly. We can get them up quickly. It's got great analgesia, great muscle relaxation. And then we can combine that with isoflurane if we need to prolong that procedure, you know, to do a series of biopsies. And no need for antibiotics. And Francois asked me to talk a bit more about that, so I'll jump into that now. Basically, this is sort of our representation of the GI tract. We've got sort of two populations of bacteria, a stool population, and then a mucosal adherent population that Jason and Dennis were talking about having a helicobacter heavy component to it. Those bacteria do produce short chain fatty acids, other molecules that nourish that mucosa, maintain those nice tight gap junctions, so we're not getting that microbial translocation. The immune system is used to seeing those mucosal adherent bacteria, so they're tolerant of those. We don't have a heavy inflammatory response, nice homeostatic environment. So we looked at the impact of antibiotics on that, taking samples of colon, blood, and stool before, during, and after antibiotics. And for this talk, I'd like you to focus on group two here, which is a first-generation cephalosporin, a class of antibiotics that's commonly used as prophylaxis associated with biopsy procedures, and the impact that has. So of course, as you would expect, it did change the, if you look at the top right here, it did change the mucosal adherent flora. It changed the stool flora. No big surprise there. We're giving antibiotic. That's what it should do. I did, looks like I left off the label here, but if you look at the blue squares, those are the cephalexin group. Although it doesn't really matter, you'll see we saw pretty consistent changes across the four different classes of antibiotics we used. But what you can see here is neutrophils infiltrating into the mucosa. This is a rectal mucosa sample, colonic mucosa sample. And these were expressing a little bit of caspases, and so they're not in there to undergo apoptosis. They're part of an inflammatory response, you know, significant local inflammatory response, probably associated with microbial translocation. We also saw elevations systemically. This is plasma soluble CD14 indicating a systemic inflammatory response, which again is typically associated with microbial translocation associated with just giving a typical prophylactic antibiotic. And then I guess I don't need to talk about the importance of Th17 cells. Tom Hope emphasized that for me. So we do see elevations in these populations, again, for weeks after the antibiotics, and again, just based on those antibiotics. So, you know, for multiple reasons, and not the least of which is when we stop using these, you know, where we've stopped using these, we really haven't seen increased complications. So, you know, we don't need them, and there's a potential impact to our models, so we've gone away from those. And obviously, with the current emphasis on antimicrobial resistance, you know, it's better for multiple reasons. So these are the types of samples that we commonly do. This is not an exhaustive list, but these are probably the most common ones that we do, or some of the most common ones we do, with the projected numbers that we're likely to hit here in 2019 based on year-to-date sampling. We do a lot of blood sampling, a lot of BALs, a great source of effector memory T cells. We do a little bit of cytobrush sampling. That's not a major thing, but I'll talk more about the utility of that in a little bit. Peripheral lymph nodes, these are mostly axillary and inguinal. We do some submandibular sampling for folks who are interested in oral mucosa and the like. Upper GI biopsies, these are endoscopic duodenal pinch biopsies. Colon biopsies, this is actually a technique where we go in with a speculum. We go in about 8 to 12 centimeters in, get that distal descending colon, sort of the area that is commonly covered by our challenge, as we showed with Brandon a few years back, and Tom just did a nice job of reiterating that challenge goes in you know, further than you might expect. A vaginal challenge again, or vaginal biopsies again. This is a speculum technique with a mucosal pinch, bone marrow aspirates, and then sort of some of the techniques we've been pioneering and publishing, the laparoscopic biopsies. What Lewis refers to as our triple biopsy. Where we get mesenteric lymph node, liver, and spleen all through 2 5-millimeter incisions. It's very minimally invasive. These animals are typically out bounced around their cages, active eating within an hour or two after the procedure, because it is minimally invasive. And again, you know, these are obviously tissues that are of interest. We've heard that over and over again. So powerful technique, and we're doing them quite frequently. And again, multiple time points. I'll talk more about that. Leukapheresis doesn't exactly meet my definition of a typical sampling technique because it's not high frequency, it's not high throughput, it takes a few hours to do one of these, but as Jonah and others have pointed out, if you need a ton of lymphocytes, this is a way to do it, so I did put that on there for that reason. Then obviously necropsy, most of our biopsies end up getting compared to a necropsy a sample collection. In terms of how we use these cells, well, you guys have seen that over and over again, a lot of flow cytometry, phenotype analysis of different cell populations, antigen-specific responses, antibody levels, viral loads, both plasma cell-associated, the RNA sequencing that we heard about just a little bit ago from Steve, microbiome analysis, which I forgot to put on my slide, but I did have some data on just a few minutes ago. Adoptive transfer of cells, which both Jonah and Lewis pointed out, is the most sensitive way of detecting a virus in these samples, and then immunohistochemistry, C2 hybridization, which Claire just went over. So this is our typical yield. What I'll point out here is that this is T lymphocyte yield from our typical sampling. The what's going into the assays at the top, the type of sample, and the yield is beneath that. The for the tissue samples, the lymph nodes, bone marrow, colon, the like, this is about a third of the sample. So typically we're splitting the sample three ways, about a third go into PFA for histologic analysis, a third being frozen or going into lysing matrix RNA later for the RNA sequencing, and then a third going for flow cytometry. So from these samples, you know, from an 8-mil blood collection, we're getting about 20 million lymphocytes. We're getting about 5 from a BAL. 75 from a peripheral or mesenteric lymph node. Our bone marrow and spleen samples, we're getting 20 to 30 million cell yields. We're getting less from the liver and the mucosal samples. There's more digestion involved in terms of getting those cells out of those samples. And the other thing I'd like to point out here is there's obviously a balance between how much you take at each time point and how many time points. Usually we're trying to hit 6, 8, 10 time points. If you want to do less time points, you could take more and get more yield at each time point. These are live cells, great for phenotype analysis. We've heard about the plasma viral loads. We do a lot of work with Jeff Listen's group on both that and the cell-associated viral loads. I'll just, again, put a plug for the importance of tissue sampling in here. This is an example of a study we did with Jonah Sasha and Justin Green. This is a couple of control animals and a vaccinated, a Cy CMV vaccinated animal. The animal never showed evidence of plasma viremia after challenges, but did have a VIF response, which, as Lewis pointed out, is not in our vaccine. So we went in 4 weeks after after the challenge and looked at viral loads. We only found virus in the mesenteric lymph nodes and the spleen, and this was confirmed by adoptive transfer, but not in the bone marrow or inguinal lymph nodes. And with these sampling techniques, we were able to follow that over time and see that the virus went away. So powerful use of these techniques. You know, Lewis already covered this, the RNA sequencing. I can't do as good a job as he did, but I find the IL-15 story incredibly fascinating and obviously a powerful use of this technology. We do get beautiful architecture from these samples. You know, I won't try to go into the RNA scope that was just gone over, but in terms of the architecture, you can see here we're getting full thickness biopsies of spleen, mesenteric lymph node that we can do full analysis on. I will point out over here we got some myeloperoxidase staining. This was actually a baseline sample for a study we were doing. It was an interrectal challenge study, and you can see the variation in background inflammation. I'm just going to put in my own plug. You know, Dennis and Vefa talked about the importance of age. Dennis mentioned obesity. David mentioned the importance of social housing in some of these models, some of these impacts. Well, I'll say that, you know, I think pre-existing colitis is an important thing. We have a lot of GI disease in these monkeys, and this is definitely a potential source of variability in our models. Vaginitis too for our vaginal challenge models. We've also looked at the importance of behavioral temperament and have some really fascinating data to show that animals that are behaviorally inhibited, sort of what I call a stress ball phenotype, they acquire virus much quicker than some of our other models. So I think that like the data that Beth was showing pre and post sexual maturity has an impact. I think some of these other things can have an impact as well, and this could help reduce some of the variability in our models if we understood this better and perhaps looked at these factors. This is the cytobrush data I was mentioning. This is the data that I got from Don Sidora. We're doing a vaccine study with him looking at epithelial vaccine versus IM vaccine. I'll just point out, we don't get a ton of yield from these, but the nice thing about them is that they're very minimally invasive. We can get a mucosal sample that we can do repeatedly, very frequently, and get some useful data there. So I think there's probably a bigger role for these than what we're currently using them. In terms of our procedures, you know, we do combine all of these. This is sort of how long they take, usually 5 to 15 minutes for most of them. The laparoscopies are more like half an hour. We can do all of these in one event. So we can get that broad look at the different sites, taking you know, peripheral lymph node, bone marrow, rectal, vaginal, the mesenteric lymph node, liver, spleen. We can do that fairly frequently. You know, all of these we can take sort of at weekly to every two week intervals. You know, prefer every 2 weeks, a little bit easier on the animals, but we have done them at weekly intervals and they go very well. In terms of the numbers here, you can see how many we do typically in a study, 6, 8, 10 time points. I'll point out here that in terms of the peripheral lymph nodes and the mesenteric lymph nodes, the big challenge there and the reason I didn't put 100% is obesity. So another reason, like what Dennis mentioned, not to have obese animals in your study, they are harder to sample. They're harder on to anesthetize as well, for that matter. They don't do as well under anesthesia. So I'll point out here one other thing, and that's the scope valve versus the scopeless valve. We used to do thousands of scope valves every year. We've 100% switched over to the scopeless valve. The scope valve uses a $90,000 bronchoscope. It's a stiff scope that irritates the airways. We see bleeding. We have the animals that have to stop having valves based on needing to use that scope. And again, we have to put 30 mils of fluid into each lung to get the same yield as we get from 30 mils into one lung with the scopeless valve. The scopeless valve uses this $1.25 sterile tube. It's a real flexible tube. We don't see inflammation. We don't have animals that they recover very well from the procedure because we're only putting fluid into one lung. And the yield is the same or better than what we get with the scope valve. So we, as I said, we're doing thousands of the scopeless valves now, and it's been a real successful transition. We've had people from around the U.S. and Canada come and you know, train on that technique. So it's something to be aware of. These are our minimally invasive triple biopsies. You know, just wanted to show you this. These are very achievable techniques. You know, I think any veterinarian who is willing to put in the time can learn these techniques. They're one instrument techniques. Very low complication rates, as you'll see here in a second. We take our spleen biopsy. We don't have a lot of bleeding, which would be one of the concerns associated with this. And we're able to combine them with a lot of other procedures. We've had studies that have gone from terminal to non-terminal because we can get these samples you know, in a non-necropsy fashion. We've had studies that would have been serial sac studies that we've been able to do within the same animal, reducing variability, reducing number of animal use. We talked about the need to use less animal, or to the, you know, the ability to get more out of animals, use less animals, and I think these techniques offer that and you know, powerful ability to sample. We've done some, you know, different types of samples. Like for Nancy, we've done, you know, biopsies of metric lymphodes of certain areas of the colon, you know, ascending, transverse, descending, go back to get exactly the same node that drains the same region to look over time at these regions. So I think there's a lot of opportunity, and I guess I would just encourage that, you know, we've published the metastatic lymph node and liver portion of this in a video Joe format, so that could be helpful to learning these techniques. And we're going to be publishing the spleen technique here shortly. So anyway, that's my plug for those. In terms of where we're going with these techniques, you know, like Tom was saying, we're going to be doing some fluorescence guided. We have a capability to do fluorescence imaging, combining that with the PET to help targeted sampling will be a powerful use of these techniques. And then, you know, biopsying other sites and other ages. So we heard from Nancy and Christina about the importance of infants. You know, this is us biopsying a portal lymph node, you know, liver draining lymph node in a 1.5 kilo infant. These are 3 millimeter instruments. We're sort of working with, you know, 1 or 2 millimeter tolerances here along the common bile duct, successfully collecting these nodes for Ben Berowitz. And you can see here we've again used the fluorescence imaging capabilities to highlight the bile duct there to show that it's not leaking, to you know, help us to know that we haven't done anything that's going to be a problem in this animal. So with that, I guess I'd like to thank a lot of people. You know, we get tremendous support and you know, a lot of use of these techniques from Lewis and Scott and Apham. You know, I talked about Jonah's data and showed the images from Ben and Nancy's study. Jake Essies does our RNA scope and the histology. Mike Gale, the RNA sequencing. I showed some of Don's data. Jeff Lifson and Brandon do all of our viral loads and viral variants. The antibiotic data we did in conjunction with the CLAT lab. And then we get great support from our surgical services unit run by Ted Hobbs and Drew Martin doing our anesthesia, and they do the endoscopic biopsies I was talking about. And then the my own team and working with Mike Axtell, and then our veterinarians, Kathy Moats and Carolyn Labriola, who do all the and Bree Fisher, I guess our lab manager, and all of our technicians who keep up with all that sampling that you saw, thousands and thousands of samples plus all the other study needs. And then unfortunately it's cut off the bottom, that's too bad, but the funding from the P51. And with that, I'll take any questions.
Have you done lung biopsies?
I have not. We do bowels, and we're starting to work on some cider brush techniques in the airways, but have not done lung biopsies.